So okay. we have our annual, sort of annual lecture by Mike Holguin, the greatest drummer on earth, in my opinion. Certainly the best reading drummer I have ever met. Mike Holguin will come into the studio and sight read the S out of your piece. To put it, you know, roughly. Better than anybody I know. He's amazing. So, and that has translated into him really knowing what a good drum part looks like and how to create a good drum part. And I say little about it in class because it's better to have Mike say it and to demonstrate it. I have a bunch of handouts that Mike made in my workbook, and he's the master. So I'm going to let him start presenting the material. I can share my screen. I have it up if you want me to do that, Mike, or however you want to handle it. And then we'll have questions and answers as we go along.
Okay, cool. Yeah. I think I could just share it from my end if that's cool.
That's fine, yeah.
I have it all right here. So let me share my desktop, and then I'm going to pull up this first one here. So you guys should have this chart writing for drum set, a couple pages of stuff here. One of the main things, you know, there's some spiel that I wrote at the top about how the drummers usually get the least attention when it comes to your chart arrangements, because usually you're on a deadline or something and you're worried about all the harmonies and all that stuff. And usually on the very last day, it's like, all right, I got to put a drum set part together. So it's usually kind of hurried. And what that leads to is just a bunch of issues as far as like all the articulations and dynamics, everything that you want to really express in an arrangement. Really, the drummer has the ultimate control of the threshold of your band, threshold dynamically, how tight you're going to articulate, really lead trumpet and the drummer. We're talking big band situation here. Those two really kind of define what type of band you're going to have. So yeah, it's everybody's responsibility to be dynamic and all that stuff. But I kind of control how loud you're going to be or how soft you're going to be, what the groove is going to feel like and things like that. So it's really super important that you guys spend a really good chunk of time getting that drum arrangement right. And the funny thing about it is it should be the easiest part to write because we don't want to see a ton of information. And I'm going to show you some examples of that. You notice the very first thing I say in here is the TMI. Too much information. If you give us just an overwhelming amount of stuff to look at, it's just going to create fatigue where we're just kind of staring at the screen and we're supposed to groove and decipher the code, if you will, what's going on in the arrangement. Simplifying is going to be the way to go. But at the same time, not too simple to where we don't get the right information. We don't want to be reading your minds and stuff like that. That happens sometimes too. The thing that's going to help us and that I see more often than not is just the lack of the courtesy counting reminders. If you have a 32-bar phrase and if you're writing out every single bar, if you don't give us in parentheses just a little, you know, here's 8 bars, here's 12 bars, 16, that means we have to stare at each bar and wait. And if we blink or something, we might miss it and be off by a bar. And we're talking a sight reading situation. If we know the song, we've been playing it for a while, then it doesn't really matter. I usually, when I get the charts, first thing I have to do almost every time is write in the rehearsal markings myself, just so that I know for myself, just to give me the phrasing so that I can get out of the chart and start to just groove and see what's going on and breathe and just think more about musical things and less about the scientific things of, you know, looking at the actual math on the page. I want to be able to feel the emotion of the music. And I can't do that. I can't get to that state if I'm just sitting there kind of staring at the math that I got to figure out. Again, help us to get to the more emotional side of the music or, you know, the impact that you're trying to create. It's surprisingly a huge help to do that. Those courtesy reminders are really a big deal. Before I move on to these other things, we have ensemble figures, horn section figures, and actual melodies. I want to show you some charts.
I always tell Mike, never use one of my charts as a bad example, even if it is one.
I know that. I can't use anybody that I work with. I actually made this up, okay? But I have seen charts like this, okay? And so I don't know if you noticed, but it's the exact same bar over and over and over again. The verse, all the phrasing is there. If I blinked, I would miss something, especially if there was a, and I threw it in there, a 9-bar phrase. God forbid you're reading a chart like this and you have a 9-bar phrase instead of an 8-bar phrase, which look, let's look at verse A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I would have totally missed that because, man, look at all this stuff that I got to try to figure out. So we're going to go through the evolution of how to fix this chart. Here's a little bit. All right, so there was page one. So I'm starting to fix some of the stuff. Okay, so now I have slashes instead of that bar written out. So that does help. I still don't have any courtesy reminders in here. So I still have to stare at every bar just in case I have this pesky 9-bar phrase. And I do have some phrasing written. They're all kind of scattered in different parts of the bars. And all right, so we added some courtesy reminders. So now I can breathe a little bit more. I know I got a 9-bar phrase. I can just look from a distance and see what's happening. So it's getting better, right? I mean, I think I can comfortably read this and feel okay. Let's see if I get less fatigue as I start to fix that. Look at this difference, putting everything on the left-hand side. So this allows me all the phrasing. And if I look away or just to see what's going on in the band and all that stuff, I can actually vibe and just get a good groove while I'm still reading this chart. So this is a big help. If you notice the difference, if we go back to the top, look at that. And the fatigue that I feel, I'm getting like PTSD just thinking about this type of chart. And then as it becomes more simplified, I can actually, I feel like my blood pressure going down quite a bit. But it can go down even more. Look at this one. It's 3 lines of music. And it's all the same information that I got from that other chart. But my blood pressure is a lot lower. There's still one thing that's confusing in here, right? I definitely like this. I like writing the groove if it's something that, you know, you want us to see. Definitely write the groove out and then give us slashes. But after that, we don't need the 1 bar and then 8 bars here, because I might misinterpret this whole thing as this is an 8-bar phrase. I purposely put this in here because I see it a lot. Somebody will write 1 bar and then write play 8 bars after that. So we have to figure out, did you mean 9 bars or did you mean 8 bars? So to fix that, here's the final draft of this. And it's just 9 bars total. There's no question about what's going on in here. And I can just easily play this chart and enjoy it and have a good time and make somebody's chart feel great. And all the phrasing right into the bridge, I would automatically know. If it's the verse, I would play a certain type of groove. It's the bridge, I would go to right cymbal. Just naturally as a musician, I know to do that, okay? Go to the chorus, I would change it up even more color-wise. And then the next verse, I would bring it back down. So having this, what type of phrase it is extremely important.
The only thing I would have added to that chart is a tempo marking and a style marking.
Right. Because
then there's no question about what the groove's all about.
Right, totally. Yeah. And so that's kind
maybe
of a...
If there's some sort of dynamic thing that you wanted, you know, that was in maybe the bridge is softer for some reason or something like that.
Right, definitely.
That's just a little bit more information, but you can get it. Goes a long way.
Totally, yeah. And that's all musical stuff that's extremely important to the chart. Okay, so let's talk about these drum set figures. Let me share my screen again. And these are drum set ensemble figures. So there's 3 main ways that I'd like you guys to think about when you're writing charts, okay? We all know when you play, when you have slashes in your music, you're grooving along and you just play time. Now, what do you do when you have the figures? There's something that the band is playing. There's 3 different things, horn figures, ensemble figures, and actual melodic figures. If it's a horn figure or a horn section figure, you usually write that above the staff, not in the staff. When you're grooving, we call that playing the line. If you have something written on top, that means you play it without breaking the line. In other words, without breaking the groove. You want to be able to keep grooving through it and play these figures. The thing about these horn figures is that they are not a mandatory thing. If you write that in there, it's really more of a suggestion. And depending on the drummer, Sonny Payne, if he was playing with Basie, he would not hit all those figures. He would hit some of that stuff. Harold Jones, same thing. Their whole approach was ba-dun-ga-dun-da-dun-ga-dun-ba-gun-ba. They might hit one or two of those figures, and I'll play those in a second.
Mike, for horn figures on the top of the staff, do you normally like to see them in cue size notes, smaller size notes?
Yeah, you can do that, or the way I have it written, it doesn't matter. You don't want it too small, you know, just depends. The way it is written here is pretty cool. It's big enough to where I can actually see it and not have to worry about it. I don't want to have to squint to see something like that. So as long as it covers the amount of a bar, if it saves you some space to do that, fine. I'm used to seeing it smaller. And we'll look at some examples of Nestico charts and Cubist charts to get a bigger idea of what their approach to it is. So this right here, the horn figures, this is the type of stuff you would do without breaking the line. So you would still be swinging through this and play some of it. This next one, if you want to deliberately have the drummer set up your figures, one, two, three, that type of thing, where they're kind of filling in between and stopping the ride pattern, then you would write it like this as an ensemble figure, slashes in the middle of the bar. And this one, it doesn't matter if the stems are down or up. This one, for sure, if you have melodies on top, please write those stems up. I'll show you some examples of these three in a second. And then this last one is a melodic approach. If you specifically want something written in the part that you really want, snare bass, or tom, whatever, if you really want those type of figures, then write it down inside in a melodic form. Now,
I'm sorry, I don't want to bog you down, but could you just quickly go over what are all the spaces?
Yeah.
And where to put the hi-hat, open hi-hat versus closed hi-hat.
So everybody kind of has a different key, and it's a little bit different depending on who the drummer is or what book you're looking at. Just so you know, the lower the frequency of the drum, the lower you are on the staff. So if it's your lowest drum is your bass drum, so that goes on the F space. If we think of this in a treble clef, even though it's really a percussion clef, bottom space is your bass drum. And just above that would be your toms, and depending on how many toms you have. Keep this in mind. When drummers are sight reading, they're not looking at, oh, is it the second tom, first tom? They're overall checking out that picture and interpreting how they feel it. So you can write whatever you want melodically in there, but if they're sight reading it, no drummer is going to specifically play the right toms and that type of thing. They'll do something that kind of matches visually what they're saying.
Sure. But if you're a middle school drummer, you know what I mean? It's like you want to be told exactly what drums to play.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think you have to know who you're writing for too. Yeah. You know, what your end audience is with the drum part. Because you'd write a little bit more in a drum part for a beginning band.
Yeah. And that's really, Karl, that's really two different worlds as far as from an arranging standpoint. If you're writing for junior high kids, you really have to give them a lot more information than you would a Basie chart.
Yeah, right. You're teaching them how to play jazz.
They're two totally different things. So if you're writing something for young kiddos, then give them a little more information than you would otherwise. Right. Yeah. Even then, just make it simplified. Nothing too crazy. But anyway, bottom space is bass drum. The second space is where your floor toms live. And then your snare drum is in that C space. And then in the E space is usually where the high toms are. And then if you have multiple toms, sometimes they use the lines. Okay. I tend to not like to use the lines because it can get really confusing. But
what if you have 40 roto toms? Just kidding.
you need a grand staff.
And what if I have two kicks? Okay, come on.
Right. Yeah, you're screwed. I don't even know what to tell you. So that top space there, that's usually where I like to put the hi-hat stuff. Some people put it on the line above. Some people put it above. I usually like to have my hi-hat on the top space with X's. X's will signify hi-hat or cymbal type thing, something metallic. And then I usually put it on the line for the ride cymbal. And then I usually put my crashes above that. Usually when there's a crash, I usually will put the X, but I'll circle it to specifically see that. But everybody does something different. And so what I do whenever I'm writing anything that has an X, I always in parentheses will put hi-hat or ride, just so that they know what it is. Everybody does their key different. I'm pretty close to kind of what the standard is, but nobody has really come out with, look, this is the standard way of doing it. But I'm pretty close. I think the top space is where you should put your hi-hat stuff.
Great. Yep.
Any questions about this stuff here? Horn figures, ensemble, and then melodic. And then I can jump on the drum set and play some of this stuff real quick, and so they can get a better idea of what's happening. Notice when you play melodic, there is no ride cymbal at all. I'm playing exactly what I see. It's written in the
That
bar.
means you're playing exactly the melody. That's what's written there is a melody, and you're playing it along with them.
Yeah, if I see something written in the bar, that tells me that the arranger specifically wanted a melodic figure. I will do my best to interpret that. I will embellish it with my own style. Gadoon, 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 badoon, bop. I would always, if I had bass drum, I would throw some ride in there to emphasize the low end. I don't necessarily have to do that. I could just specifically play what's written: snare bass, snare bass, snare bass, snare bass, snare bass, snare. And then I'll show you how all three of these feel. If you had this written in the horns, you can do these three different versions and still have the same thing in the horns. You get three completely different feels in there. Same thing down here. So the horn figures again, one and two, ah, do ah, do ah. I would be swinging through that whole thing, even though it looks like I forgot to put the slashes here. But one and two and three and four, and one and two and three, one, two, ba, ba. I would be grooving through that. This one, I would not be grooving through it. I would be actually doing fills inside there. Ba ba do ah ba do ah ba do ah, and then a da ga do ba do ah ba do ah. I would stop the groove, stop, break the line, fill in that type of thing, which is a completely different feel and vibe than this. So be specific. That one little change, putting it from above to putting it in the ensemble figure, really completely change the way your arrangement sounds. And then the bottom, I might, just to be hip, be like Peter Erskine, I would play no time at all, and I would just specifically play what's written. One, two, three, four. Ba, boom, 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 ba, boom, boom. Kadeen, swinging after that, you know, something that just is pretty cool and different. Three of the same things, but three completely different feels. I'm gonna jump on the drum set and play some of this, if that's okay.
Yeah, I still consider myself a learner when it comes to writing these drum parts. I have Mike. Usually, whenever I have a session, I have Mike on the session, and he's.
This is how we develop our vocabulary, besides listening to recordings and transcribing stuff. As far as exercises, this is like the book that every drummer that's serious about drumming knows. Okay. So you re don't really have to look at the bottom, the bass drum, every beat. We don't really look at that. If you're first learning it, then yes, we. That type of thing. But what we want to get to is playing melodies on the drum set. So we need to be able to play just a swing pattern and then play the top line. And then the way we learn it is eighth notes are on the snare drum and the quarter notes are on the bass drum. And then so with that exercise alone, we can come up with melodies. And to save us time, I'm going to play it a little bit quicker. So here we go. I'm going to play exercise one, not the whole thing, but like four lines of it. Just listen for the melodies that I'm playing. If it's long percussive, anything tied or anything the length of a quarter note, it's on the bass drum. If it's a short note, short percussive, it's going to be snare drum. Here we go. Okay, so that was the first four lines of it, and this is an extremely important part of our growth as drummers. All right, so let's look at this here. This is the sheet music that we got in the Navy band. Our job now, if you look, those figures are not written inside the staff. They're put above,
but it's okay. The whole, we understood the idea is to kick every single thing that we see. Another big important part to being a drummer is knowing how to do this. Okay. So when you write it on a chart, we should automatically know that we set up these figures. If we're coming into line number two, we don't do this. A one, two, three, four, one. Right? You always set it up. So here it is. I'm going to play this whole thing. That was the whole thing, straight down. The only thing I had to think short percussive was the very last note. If they're long percussive, we know to hit long instruments. All right. All right. If we want short, we know. When you write accents on a chart, we know what to do. We should know to hit the crashes and stuff like that. When we see caps on the chart, we automatically know to be melodic. We should all know to play long percussive and then short percussive when it calls for that in the chart. Those two things, the Ted Reed syncopation, right, and the kicking of the sheets, can get you through any song. All right, so back to this. And so now this will probably make more sense since we know the first one, horn figures, drummers are gonna treat that like a Ted Reed syncopation. You know, swing, two. Notice I kept the groove going through this. And then now I'm going to do the second one. This one is where I actually set up the figures. Okay, so a lot more energy when you do that. When you write inside the ensemble, you can do it soft too. Doesn't have to be loud like I did, but I wanted to give you an example of whatever the dynamic that's written underneath it will determine how aggressive I am with the part there. Then the last one being melodic, where I actually play what's written. One, two. Notice I didn't play any ride. I could have. Here it is with the ride. I could just naturally do that to add a little more flavor into that. And every drummer's going to play it completely different. We all should understand how to do these three basic things. The horn figures on top, where it's the groove keeps going. The ensemble figure, where we break the line to do the figure. And then the last one, where we completely stop the groove and play what's written in the part.
Could you go over some of those other pages in the original handout?
Let's look at that first one. Basie, yeah. Straight ahead, Sammy Nessico. So as far as your inspiration, who to follow, like who should you write your charts like? Sammy Nessico and Tom Kubis. Both incredible as far as the information that they give you. Because notice there's stuff written melodically inside. There's ensemble figures written inside. And then there's moments, I think if you scroll down more, where there's figures written on top. The very last line.
Uh-huh. And then you've got these little bits, like you really want you to fill here right before
right
this figure.
And then that bottom one, the trumpet thing, right? So mm-hmm. I love that one because I know I don't have to hit all that. All I have to hit is those ties. One, yeah. Two, ah, ba, do, ah, ba, do, ah, zoo, ba. And then that's totally going to just swing and feel great. That's so Nestico, man. Just he, you know, the way he gives you everything that you need, and it's no wonder that Harold Jones and Sonny Payne, just the way they swung in those bands. I mean, when you have charts like that, it's just a piece of cake. I could play that chart if you want. I have the recording of that. And that one's got a lot.
The bass you straight ahead? Yeah. And my students have all heard it too.
Okay, cool. Well, let's play. And I'm gonna try my best to play what's written. I'll try to come in whenever. 3, 4. Thank you for those rehearsal markings or the courtesy reminders. And one thing I love, whenever I see a crescendo, I just naturally know if I just play that second to last line, 6 bars before F, I'm just going to play that from there. If you notice, whenever I see a crescendo, if I'm grooving along, I will immediately disappear from the sound whenever I see a crescendo. So I have a lot of space to build things, okay? You can write that musically, you can put pianissimo and all that funny stuff, but all Sammy wrote for me was just that big old crescendo, and I automatically know, drop that sucker down so that I can create a lot of intensity by the end of that. Let me play those 6 bars. So by popping out of the sound, it creates all of this momentum. You can write like subito piano if you want. That's typical Sammy Nestico chart. It's why I love them and feels so good. It's the right amount of information. This one's faster, so I'm glad he didn't write a lot. You notice he did put some horn figures on top at letter B. This one's pretty fast. I would hit maybe half of that stuff. Let's keep scrolling down. Let's see what we got here.
Oops, sorry. There we go.
All good. Like we were talking about the dashes and the dots. The other thing too, if you notice at letter F, notice that the brass has the hat thing. One poop ba doo ba doo, right? The opening and the closing. So just so you know, if it's a plus sign, you would treat it like a closed hi-hat and then the circle being open. So it'd be staccato tenuto, back and forth. I think the tempo's here. So that's the approach I would have. If it's short percussive, I would approach it just like Ted Reed, play short on snare, longer on the bass drum. Doesn't necessarily have to be those two. You can do, you know, other versions of it, but that's how I would interpret that. Oh, this is one thing at the end of my little packet. If it's a small group thing, I obviously don't need a big band type chart. It gives me the right amount of information. I love seeing chord progressions. It just helps me to play more musically, to play more melodically when I'm seeing something like this. And in moments like 18, bar 18, going into the key change into 19, whenever I see that A over B, I know it's a sus type vibe, I'm automatically going to do something special there to set up the new key change. I would change color at the key change, that type of thing. Having a chord chart like this is fine. I wouldn't use this for a big band chart, but if I was in a session, TV sports promo, a chart like this is perfect. It gives me all the stuff that I need in it. So I thought I'd throw that in there for you guys. All right. Now look at Cubis's charts. This makes my blood pressure just go way down. Oh man, I can just chill. I mean, this is the epitome of drum charts. Look, the left side is all of the phrasing. Everything is there. So I can chill. I don't even have to count. I just know it from bar five. I know it's an 8-bar phrase by the way the shape of it all looks. I don't need to stare at anything. And he has specific things in the bar ensemble figures. He has horn figures written on top. And once in a while, he'll have little melodic figures if he wants you to specifically play something. Kubis is very good about just letting the drummer do what he needs to do. He doesn't give you too much information. Definitely one of my favorite composers, arrangers. Yeah, look at this one. This one looks real clean, right? I got the courtesy reminders, and it's fast. It gives me just the right amount of information. Now, all the rehearsal markings aren't on the left, but it's okay. It doesn't necessarily have to be on the left. Oh, gosh. Yeah, let's go back. Okay, yeah, we can move on. Oh, my gosh. This one. I had to cross out who the person was who wrote. I don't even think I can play this. Look at what I would have to read before I even played this chart.
Yeah, there's all these hollow notes that have, you know, flies on them.
One played with stick, right hand on the corner.
There's a legend. There's a legend at the top.
Right? That's cool. All right? If you want me to play something like that, great. But I don't need to see every single bar. It's the same thing the entire song. See, there's some hits that I could have done, like, before whatever that first bar phrase is. Yeah, right before that, the beat before that. One, two, pop, two, three, da-da. I might have missed that because I'm so busy staring at the... Right?
Yep.
Over and over again. So, yeah, whenever I see a chart that has a lot of ink on it like that, I just,
Like, no.
Yeah, like, no. I'll try my best. Same type of thing. I have to figure out what is the groove and what are the hits. And it all kind of looks the same. So this is kind of typical if you're writing for younger drummers. You might want to give them more information. But even then, it's just too much. What are the chances that a junior high kid is going to be able to nail this? You have the top of this. One, two, three, four. You know, I had to figure out, okay, oh, that those two bar three and four, oh, that's the groove. And then we're back to ensemble figure. Oh, and then we're back to groove again, back to ensemble figure. It's a lot of back and forth stuff where if you would have just gave me slashes, right, the first bar out, that's fine, first couple bars, then give me those ensemble figures, then I know what to do. There's a lot that could have been done to clear up this chart. Mm-hmm. Cool arrangement, but okay, so let's move on. All right, this one. So this is... Tower Power Tune. And here's the whole groove. One, two. And then there's this. Two, three, and four. Ah, there's a hit on and a four. Can you, without Karl pointing it out, the whole idea was, can you find that by looking at that chart? How long would it have taken you to figure out that, oh, that one super important hit is on the end of four, the bar before A? You had to decipher all the code and then figure out that the one hit that you actually needed was that one. If you look at the next page, I rewrote this really quickly there. So this is two full pages, right? Look at that. Both, that's two full pages. And then look at my chart. That is the same information and it's half of a page. And you could look at the eighth bar of the verse, or even the hit right before the verse, two and three and four. Now, I would have played the chart better reading this chart, my chart, just because I can actually relax and get into the feel of it. The other one, I would have had no choice but to stare at it and figure out, you know, what's going on. And, you know, emotionally, I would not have been able to get into the song. I would have been busy trying to do all the math necessary for the tune. On the second page of my little packet that you guys have, I talk about using the word Latin. Okay. So if you're going to write an Afro-Cuban chart or something or Brazilian thing, please understand the style that you're playing in. I can't tell you how many times I've had to play this with my feet, which is a Brazilian ostinato, while I play an Afro-Cuban thing, sometimes even written on the cowbell. So I have like... while I'm playing like a 3-2 clave in the left hand, three completely different worlds.
Kitchen sink, baby.
Then, you know, the guy who writes the chart is like, I don't know why it doesn't feel good. I wrote all the information. Sounds great on Sibelius, right? Everything sounds great on Sibelius. Anyway, just understand the styles. And then I believe you guys have these four pages of Afro-Cuban grooves. I have them all detailed. And the cool thing now, since this whole pandemic, I'm almost done. Two of these pages I have on YouTube, me playing through the different grooves. So that's you awesome. Have that, which we didn't have before. And cool. I'll get these other two on YouTube sometime. Just know the history of what you're playing, and you know, try not to mix cultures. South America is way different than a Cuban thing and stuff like that. My four sheets that I have is kind of my, you know, all the years of
the summation. Yeah.
All right, go ahead. Yeah, is that Hindi?
Hindi.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, it seems like some of the Latin jazz is just kind of vaguely Latin. I mean, maybe because I don't know, you know, so what if it's not really very close to the actual Latin stuff, but it's just kind of, you know, generalized? Yeah. What do you do in a case like that?
Well, the perfect example of that is Elvin Jones and the way
hard bop,
the way he swung his mambo grooves, you know, instead of playing he did this kind of thing. And so one note that I did put in my little packet is, if you are wanting a specific thing like that, or a certain recording that inspires you, put that in the notes.
A la Elvin,
a la Steve Gadd, if it's, you know, the thing, you know, or even the recording, a la, you know, Ponciana. Right. It's like the thing that Peter Erskine was doing, you know, anything like that. If it's a specific groove that you heard on another recording, put those in the notes so that the drummers know to check that out. Especially in this day and age where we can just YouTube it. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah. A lot of information here. Thanks again, Mike, for killing it and for putting together that packet. Just tons and tons of great information, and I'm still learning.
Yeah, no problem. Hey, learning. Those of you who are not in that class, if you need any of this information, just let me know and I can email you all that stuff. Afro-Cuban sheet.
Really, man?
Thanks, man.
Really? Can I come by your house later?
Come on over, man.